mostly because it's beautiful. It's a little goddessy without being directly goddessy. Every time I do a puzzle, I think about the mythological aspects of it and how it can help with our psyches. And I've always wanted to do a video about it. It's actually one of the very first videos I've ever considered making. So because I got this brand new puzzle, and it is so beautiful. Just sorting puzzle pieces, right? But from a mythological standpoint, sorting seeds, sorting lentils from seeds, sorting seeds from ashes, all of those things are a really important process that happened in a lot of fairy tales. And in the Psyche and Eros myth, it's Psyche's first task from Aphrodite to make herself proven that she's Eros. So it's actually a pretty important skill set from a psychological perspective, and you might have dreams that include sorting or sifting or otherwise getting to the details, or you might feel compelled to do a jigsaw puzzle. When I'm sorting seeds mentally, I really like the idea of jigsaw puzzles. And when I'm not sorting seeds, they sound tedious and awful. I find that they tend to go with that mood in me and with that activity. And so when I'm in that process of sorting, I find that getting a jigsaw puzzle is kind of a ritual for me. And I actually turn it into a little mini ritual. Which, you know, you can tell I have so many ritualistic items here on the table. I've got my box and the poster that I'm going to use to cover up the pieces so the cats don't get them. So the thing is that it's not supposed to be fast, but they always have, the thing is it's not expected to be fast. It is in the story, but in the reality, it would probably be a really slow process. So they always have helpers, and the helpers that appear are small. I have a very pudgy feline helper. And so ants help Psyche in the Psyche and Eros story. And one of the ways that they interpret that, I think Marie-Louise is the one that interprets it differently, is that that is actually the subconscious. That's the power of the subconscious. That's the power of the unconscious that is bubbling up to help Psyche with her task. It's help coming from below. It's something that comes up, and you know, we consider ants, you know, they're super teeny tiny, and there's a bunch of them, and you know, they work in community, and there's all of these things that we can kind of amplify about the idea of ants, but they help her with her task, and they help her with the sorting of the seeds. And so if we think about that with ourselves, so let's bring this into the real world a little bit. Sorting of seeds happens when you need to separate the wheat from the chaff. There's another idiomatic expression about separating and sifting. It happens when you need to discern details and know what is valuable and what is not valuable. That's wheat and chaff. Chaff is not valuable parts of the husk of the grain, and wheat is what we want in our bread. So, ooh, we have a corner piece. Yay, that's important. So what we want to do is ensure that we're separating what we want and what we need to work with from the larger picture, from the larger pile of stuff. So that might be going through job listings. It might be sifting through options on Tinder. It might be weighing your options in terms of even like what you want out of life and career paths and where you want to go. And the thing is that usually this comes up when it's a big life. Please don't eat my puzzle pieces, big boy. It usually happens. You usually have these big transitions, or usually have these things happen things that I like are more patterny and putting things together and making them neat and tidy rather than, you know, anything that's chaotic. And so, like, look for those patterns where your psyche is calling out for that kind of order making and that kind of discernment and sorting task. And then, like, if you get a jigsaw puzzle, what you're allowing yourself to do is embody the sorting task. You're literally asking your hands to do the work that your brain has been doing. And what that does is your body is much closer to your subconscious. Your body is where a lot of your subconscious resides, because we're modern Western people and we're disconnected from our bodies in a lot of ways. Our pets are also really nice representatives of our subconsciousness. So clearly I'm excited about this video. But the animal body is actually a really nice way to get in touch with the subconscious self. So in order to create a little ritual to tap into your own subconscious and ask it to do some of this discerning work, to ask it for maybe a telling dream, or maybe, you know, the next day or after you finish the puzzle, you will understand what it is you're deciding. So it can help with, like I said, big decisions, and understanding what it is you really want, and from a kind of soul deep subconscious level rather than, you know, just mentally. And so you can kind of give your subconscious this homework of, you know, help me discern what I want to do and kind of just set it out there. I'm personally going through a pretty big career transition right now, and I really want to have my bills paid by doing creative work, and that's what I'm really moving into. And I'm fielding a job position that might allow me to do that, and I'm not sure I want to take it or not. And I think it's exactly what I'm looking for, but I'm a little afraid it's too good to be true. And so I need help discerning. And so that is where my seed sorting physical body is going to be able to look at the flags and look at the decisions and go, okay, here's what's really going on. Here's what we need to pay attention to. And these border pieces are going to be awful to put together because they're all brown lines. Okay. just noticing my puzzle selection that has very little variance on the outside edge. So, I've got three of my corners down. No, two of the corners. I thought I had three. I hope I had it on me. I hope this is making sense from how you can actually do this in your life. And one of the things that I want to talk about is, like I said, this is a theme that shows up a lot in fairy tales. And so, one of the fairy tales that, like, comes off the top of my head is Cinderella. There are a couple of versions of Cinderella where she has got her dress from the linden tree, or from her fairy godmother, or from wherever. And the stepmother says, okay, well, you can go to the ball if you get all of these lentils out of the ashes. And then she pours a whole bunch of lentils and seeds into the ashes in the fire place in the kitchen. And that's when the birds come in. There's a really great version of Cinderella that one of the folklorists on Twitter pointed out, where the fairy godmother doesn't get the birds to come clean up the ashes or the lentils. She just gives her a brand new bowl of lentils and sweeps up the ashes and it's like, okay, you can go. You should just get the new ones. And I don't know. I find that hilarious and also something worth considering when we're looking at it from shut and just got this painting and said, here, okay, it's done. I have the picture. What does that mean? What does that look like psychologically? I mean, yeah, I guess it's viable. And I like how practical it is. But I'm not entirely sure how to translate that into, like, applications to my real life based on the stories. I'm pretty sure Rumpelstiltskin, Rumpelstiltskin is mostly doing the weave spinning gold out of straw, but I seem to remember that there's also a picking up seeds element to that one. There's more than one. A fairy tale, like pretty standard Grimm kind of fairy tale or Perrault, French fairy tale, where seed sorting and sifting and getting all of this out of separating wheat from chaff is absolutely a common way of having to think about the psyche. So one of the interesting things that I would point out is actually that it's never just that one task. It's never just seed sorting. Seed sorting is usually the first task, and it's usually one of three or four. So if you're seed sorting, you've got road ahead of you. You've like, okay, so I'm going through this transitional process with my job. And if I'm seed sorting and I'm looking at that as a road ahead of me, then you know that I've been, I've also got to do the next step and the next step and the next step. If we look at specifically the Psyche and Eros myth, she has four tasks that she does for Aphrodite. The first is the sorting of the seeds with the help of the ants. The second is she has to collect golden fleece from the solar rams, the rams that are run by Helios. And if she actually goes up to these rams, she's going to get killed. And so a little river reed whispers to her from the side of the river and says, just wait till they take their noon nap. Wait until the sun gets high and they're going to take a nap. And then you can go in and just collect all of the fleece that's been caught on the briars that they're walking past. You don't even have to go near them. So she listens to the reed, which is her little helper in that particular story, and she basically has to act patience. It's literally patience. She has to sit down and wait. And can you imagine? You've got this indomitable task, and you've got this huge road ahead of you, and the first thing you're told to do is be quiet. It's that hurry up and wait. And if you've got a huge life transition, hurry up and wait is pretty familiar, and it's really frustrating. And so that is, again, that patience and that idea of, okay, I've got to do something, you know, about this, and I've got to be really patient about it. And then I can go in and kind of sideways go get what I want, like, not really directly facing it head on, but instead, like, kind of sneak in the side door and get it. And that, again, is stitches together and know then the shape and size of what the rest of this is going to come together as. So that's the next step. And again, your little jigsaw puzzle is a ritual of patience. The third task of Psyche for Aphrodite is to capture a flask of, a crystal flask full of water from the source, the spring of the river Styx. So the river Styx is the river, as you know, that flows, one of the five rivers that flow in Hades in the underworld of the Greeks. And the rivers are hatred, pain, fire, forgetfulness, forgetfulness, and I forgot the fifth one. So the river Lethe is one that a lot of people are familiar with. That's forgetfulness, and the river Styx is hatred. So the goddess of love wants Psyche to go get her a flask from the source of the river of hatred. All right, I'm missing that corner piece and I don't like it. But I don't know what else I can do about it. I'm just gonna up. All right. Hopefully nobody's eaten it. So, if you think about the ways that we've got, so if you think about it, you basically have to think about the concept of the goddess of love is looking from the river of hate. Like, what the heck is that? What does that mean? What is that about? And I really honestly think that it's about the fact that they're from the same, that their passion, their love and hate are closer in reality and in form to one another than love and indifference or love and fear. And so I feel like she wants the vial of hate water, as it were, because it is actually something that would be in her domain. The other way that you could think about Aphrodite wanting the vial of hate, but from the spring of hate, is that the Styx was what the gods used to swear oaths on. So it would be for promises. And again, the goddess of love might absolutely want to extract a promise from someone. And so having a vial of the water where gods promised and made oaths might be really useful to her. I don't know. There's nothing in the myth that explains why Aphrodite wants that vial, nor does she ever actually say what she does with it. Just like she doesn't say what she does with the fleece from the solar rams either. So, what we've got then is another conundrum where poor Psyche has no idea what she's supposed to do and how she's supposed to make this happen. She doesn't really have a way of getting up these cliffs that are like breakneck up these cliffs to actually figure out how to dip this little flask in this spring. Like, she's again, like, completely out of her depth, which again, in these big life transitions, that feels accurate, right? We get in over our heads and we're like, what do we do now? So I feel like that's, again, part of the process for most of us. And what she then does is she gets help from Zeus's eagle. And one of the, I think it's Eric Neumann who wrote about why Zeus's eagle helps Psyche. And the thing is that Zeus has been, Zeus is susceptible to Eros, Cupid, who is Psyche's would-be husband. Zeus is susceptible to him, and he is also able to ask favors of him. And there's one particular story where Cupid did So, Zeus kind of owes, he owes Cupid one, he owes Eros a favor. He's like, okay, he did me a solid, I owe him one. So, he's actually acting out of kindness for, like, this other god that he kind of owes a favor to. And I think that, so Neumann writes a lot about how all of the helpers in the Psyche myth are actually significant of Eros growing up and kind of growing into his abilities and growing into who he is. And I think that's an interesting way to look at it. You know, the important thing to know about any of these interpretations of any of these stories is that nobody's right. There's not just one. It's yes and. It's like the improv rule of yes and. Yes, it's you know, Eros growing up, and it's Psyche's journey to becoming more of herself. Yes, it's you know, Zeus owing one to Cupid or to Eros, and it's also, you know, the idea of how we grow as individuals when we're doing stuff and going on these, like, spiritual journeys. So if we yes and a little bit, and we say, okay, so Zeus helps him because he owes him a favor, and this is an impact of the masculine helping us out. Okay, great. That's good to know. Finally, what we get out of this little mix, though, is that Psyche gets this vial and returns it to Aphrodite. When she does that, Aphrodite gives her fourth and final task, which is no mean feat. For her fourth and final task, what she has to do is go to the underworld, visit Persephone in the underworld, and retrieve a beauty potion, because Aphrodite's been up all night because of her concern for Eros, and so she needs a beauty potion before the big party of the gods. So she needs for Psyche to go retrieve this for her. And so she has to go to the underworld and ask for Persephone to give her a beauty potion, essentially. So again, she's in over her head. She doesn't even know the way to get to the underworld. She's a little bit confused about all of this anyway. And she feels like she's just not going to be able to do this. Like, she kind of loses her ability to cope to a certain extent. So she's like standing at the top of this tower, and if you're familiar with the tarot, the tower is a sudden insight. It's often a surprise. It's often a aha moment for yourself. It's often a, oh, that's what's going on here. So she's standing at the top of this tower and realizing that she has no idea what she's doing. And the tower itself speaks to her. The tower itself says, nah, girl, I got you. You're fine. This is what you need to do. And the tower tells her, you take two pieces of honey-soaked bread, barley-soaked, honey-soaked barley bread, basically, and you put one in each hand, and in your mouth you put two coins, and you don't talk to anybody. And then when you get, you know, you get to the gates of the underworld, you spit out one of the coins for the driver of the ferry, and he'll take you over there, but don't talk to anybody and don't talk to him. And then when you see Cerberus, give him one of the barley-soaked cakes, and so you'll get past the dog. And then when you're walking up to the palace, don't stop, don't talk to anybody. There's no time, you gotta keep going. And then she says some really important stuff along that way. But basically, then the tower says, then go ask for Persephone to give you this thing. And then on the way back, do the exact same thing. You have the barley. you gotta keep going. And you just have to, you know, do your best, basically. So that's the overall feeling of that journey. So she does it, and then she realizes that she's about to win. She's about to go meet her husband, who is the god of love, right? So she's gonna go meet the god of love, and she's been doing all these tasks. She's been playing with sheep and collecting stuff and, you know, having ants sort her seeds, and she's like, she looks like a wreck. She's been to hell and back, literally. She looks like a wreck. And so she's like, well, maybe if there's a little bit more beauty ointment in this thing that Persephone gave to Aphrodite, maybe there's something here for me. And the thing you know about Persephone is that she's the goddess of the underworld. One of the important things to know about the Greek idea of underworld is that it includes sleep and dreams. Morpheus is sometimes considered to be a son of Hades. And so sleep and dreams are a key part of the underworld myths when it comes to Greek mythology. So, of course, when she, you know, takes what she doesn't deserve and tries to take the healing potion of the underworld, it's sleep, and so she falls into sleep and is unable to be woken, and it actually takes a special favor again of Eros asking Zeus for help in order to get her to wake up again. But then she's able to drink from the cup of the gods and drink the nectar and become a full-fledged goddess. And she's one of the, like, Hercules and a couple of other, Asclepius, a couple of other mortals were made into gods. She's one of the few that is a woman that is made into a god via her story. So that's kind of fun. I feel like she's got so much to offer us in terms of understanding how all of this comes together in our own lives. Clearly I'm not that great at both talking and doing jigsaw puzzles, and I hope y'all are okay with that. So I think that what I'm getting at is, you know, she goes to the underworld and then is made a goddess, right? I think what I'm getting at with all of this is that sorting the seeds is just the first part, and that we have to learn this level of discernment as a task that is really kind of part of life, and it's part of our psyches, and it's part of how we work as human beings. I think that what I find useful in the process of sorting seeds and whatnot is I'm really able to kind of understand what it is I'm working on. If I have a story that matches up with what I'm working on, like if there's a story that says, okay, here's the path forward, you know, you're talking about this thing, and here's how that path like kind of plays out, that's what I like about it. I feel like it's it's kind of a to-do list in a really dorky way. It tells me, okay, so you're sorting seeds, you're in a discerning place. The next step is going to be something besides sorting seeds. And so let's talk about that. Let's think about that. How does that look? How does that feel? What does that look like in your life? And having, you know, a myth or a story that tells me that can be really comforting. you. I hope that at the very least it was calming and not utterly frustrating to watch me